We'd like to remind you of our listening room policy and ask that you please keep table conversation to a minimum during the performance and silence your phone out of respect to those around you and the musicians on stage. The use of flash photography is prohibited, as is the use of any recording equipment.
What's up?
On behalf of Jazz St. Louis and our restaurant partner, Birch Culinary Company, we sincerely hope you enjoy the performance.
How's everyone doing tonight? My name is Darren Jackson. I'm the Director of Education and Community Engagement here at Jazz St. Louis, and it is a pleasure to welcome you all into the Steward Center here, home of Jazz St. Louis. Give yourselves a hand. We're happy to be here tonight to be able to present a retrospective of a man named Ronald Carter. Although not from East St. Louis, Illinois, he made an indelible impact on the city and this region. And we're happy for his life and his legacy. He was originally supposed to be a part of this event tonight. And unfortunately, we all know what happened last month. And so I am delighted that we were able to turn this into a retrospective of his life and have everyone on stage that you see participate. Give them a hand. We have various members of the East St. Louis Lincoln High School band. I don't think there's anyone from a class in the 70s, but we got some 80s. We got some 70s? We got two of the 70s. Three. That was before I was born, so I'm sorry.
You wouldn't know about that.
I wouldn't know about that. But we're going to have a good time tonight. And we're so happy that you all came to celebrate his life and legacy with us. We also have some members of alumni of the Northern Illinois University band. You know, when Carter left East St. Louis, he went up to DeKalb, Illinois to lead that program, Northern Illinois. So we're so happy that these gentlemen were able to celebrate with us to bridge two families with a lot in common. So we're very, 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 very happy about that. I'm going to stop talking right now because we want to start with song, right? We want to start with song, right? Y'all got to do better than that. I was told almost every seat is filled in here. Y'all got to do better than that. And we're streaming live. You got to do better than that. So we'll start with KC Blues. Welcome Reggie Thomas to the stage.
Thank you.
1962. My brother Eddie Thomas. Oh, he said 1980, but I just know when I got here, he had already raised the full crop, so. From the class of 19, you say it out loud. Now, 1990, Jason Brown. From the class of 1988, Mr. Reginald Gully. From the class of 1989, Mr. Andre Roberson. And from the class of 98, from Belleville West High School. We're including it by extension. John, I'm getting ready to mess up your last name. Siddle. John Siddle. That first number was something that, is there anybody in the band, that was in the band at Lincoln, that did not play KC Blues? That was one of the first things that we all had to play. So much so, I don't even remember who wrote that. But I knew it so well that I could remember that arrangement and write it especially for this group to do. That's how much we played that. That was the KC Blues. Thank you. I'm not going to talk behind everything, but I'm here to introduce one of the earliest members of this ensemble. I'm going to say a little bit about him before I come up. He didn't know I was going to say it, but with my brother and with Bruce, they graduated just before I got to Lincoln, so we were never in school at the same time. And I thought I was a bass player when I got there. That was what I planned on playing. But a couple of other bass players, one of them you'll hear tonight, had shown up and there was no piano player. So Carter said, "You playing piano." Thus began my piano career. But I only say that to say this. If I needed any motivation to practice and to become a hopefully a halfway decent pianist, it was because what I had to hear all the time when I got in the band is, "Hey y'all, let's play Spain." "Oh, we can't play that anymore because Bruce not here." "Y'all remember the solo Bruce used to play on No Mystery?" "Oh, we can't play that no more because Bruce not here." "Y'all remember how Eddie used to play KC Blues?" "We can't play that no more." And I said, "Oh no, they will not say that." So the person whose shadow, one of the people whose shadow I had to live in, please welcome Mr. Bruce Allen. Class of 1980.
Thank you, Reggie. Thank you, Reggie. And what a hell of a piano player he turned out to be. And I had to live, you know, with having him come and they play and they say, "You wait till Reggie, wait till he get to that solo, wait." So Mr. Carter was an incredible, incredible man. His vision was just impeccable. And tell you a little bit about myself. I come from a family, you know, from a Pentecostal background and all of that. So I came out of Church of God in Christ, and you know, you had to be, you cannot join in. You got to be born in, and folk that know, y'all know what I'm talking about. And anything you do outside of Church of God in Christ was devil. The devil's music. That's the devil's music. You can't play that. No, son, you keep your music in the hands of the Lord. And Mr. Carter happened to hear me playing because I was in around in Miss Kimbrell's class. She was the piano instructor in high school. And Miss Kimbrell had invited told Mr. Carter about me, and I started going to the band room, and Mr. Carter said, "Man, you got to get in the jazz band, Bruh Rabbit." So I told him, I said, "Man, I can't get in the jazz band because my mom and daddy ain't going to ever let me get in no jazz band." So he said, "Man, where you live? Where you live? I'm coming to your house. I'm talking to your parents because they're going to let you play in this jazz band." And he came to my house, man. It was like, you know, the Third World War, you know. And Carter was talking to my parents, talking to me, and then he picked up on my dad loved music. My dad loved, he was a self-taught guitarist and self-taught piano player, and he loved music. And so, Carter picked up on that, and Carter started selling. If you let your child in the jazz band, I'm going to get him a scholarship, you know, he's going to go to college, you know, be able to go to college scot-free, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And about 3 hours later, I was in the Lincoln Senior High School jazz band. And I want to say this one other thing about Mr. Carter. I had a stroke, and some of you know that have had a stroke. I had a stroke. My right side was affected and weakened. My speech was terrible. So I was going through speech therapy and physical therapy and all of that. And Mr. Carter heard about it. And Mr. Carter called me, and Mr. Carter said, "Don't give up, Bruce," because I couldn't play anything. I could not play, and he would always call me over a couple of years, you know, over the years that it took me to get back. He would always tell me, "Don't ever give up, Bruce." And he brought me up to North Carolina, where he was in Fayetteville at the university there. And we played in a club together. And, man, what that did for my confidence was amazing. But that was the kind of man that Mr. Carter was. He never forgot you. And so I want to play a song called "Come Back, Come Back." And it's me coming back into music. And I want to dedicate this to Ron Carter.
Please welcome to the stage Mr. John King.
Mr. Bruce Allen.
We're going to call up another old head, early band member from back in the day. We'll put it like that. Early band member from back in the day. And it's something, as you, when you're a musician and youngster, you all right, Long? Oh, okay. But not long, ladies and gentlemen. When you're a musician, you're a lot of times asked, you know, who are your idols? Who are the people that you listen to and that you like growing up? And one of the things that was a constant with this program, and every person sitting up here can tell you this, the people that we idolized first, I mean, we all had our heroes that we then picked out later, professional musicians, that type of thing. But the people that we idolized first were the people that came before us in this program. And so when I got to Lincoln, yeah, one of the people that I idolized was this young, was this man sitting right here. Please welcome class of 1981, Mr. Lenny Yarbrough.
The youngsters these days. Well, first, on behalf of those early bands, certainly want to extend our condolences to Linda Carter and to the entire Carter family. Yeah, we can give. And, you know, Reggie and I, we go back a ways, and we were upstairs in the room there, and we said, we're not going to cry. You know, we're not going to do it. I'm already crying inside. But let me just say this. Bruce and I were the first two people to go to state and represent the finest elite musicians in the state of Illinois. And Mr. Carter had a lot to do with that. He had everything to do with that. Because, see, I was a kid from the John DeShields. Y'all know where that's at? See, the John DeShields ain't quite like it was back then. But nevertheless, I literally live right across the street from the band room. And I'm going to say this, Mr. Carter and Mr. DuPart back in the day, but Mr. Carter is who we're talking about today. He demanded excellence.
We didn't even know
that we were being excellent. Until we fanned out across the country as graduates from Lincoln High School, and we were excellent not just in music, but we were excellent in as NASA scientists, as mathematicians. We were excellent in everything we did. I myself did not go into music. I became a government employee, and I led a team and retired at 59. You see, I just want to say that there was no future for me in the John DeShields. We didn't even think as kids that we would live to 30 years old. But it was Mr. Carter who took us to Europe, right? Y'all remember that? He took us to everywhere. We went up to Chicago, and people would say, who are these people? We played one night with McCoy Tyner. You know, the band after us, they played with Clark Terry and all, you know? Come on now, y'all don't understand what I'm saying. Huh? Y'all don't get that? Huh? Show me a high school doing that right now. Huh? That's what the deal was. So we'd like to play a song next. that was a very important song in the band when I was in the band, because I came along as a classical flute player. I played with Vera Bowden. I think she's out there. I think she accompanied me on my first solo at Hughes Quinn, right? And so I was a classical flute player. So Mr. Carter had some for me when I got up to Lincoln. And it was a Hubert Laws tune called The Baron, you know? And Reggie called me a few weeks ago and said, Lenny, dust off The Baron. I was like, but before I sit down, I really want to acknowledge that Mr. Carter was, and I know if he could hear me now calling him Mr. Carter, he's like, Lenny, Ron, call me Ron. But I just can't do it. In February, I think it was, he came to Memphis where I live, and I chauffeured him around. Get this. He went to 3 high schools in a day. And he taught bands how to do dit dot. What? He taught them how to play jazz, right? So now think about this. Say it's like 20 or 30 people in a band. 3 times a day, 3 days. How many people did he impact? Huh? How many people did he impact? Now you multiply that times 17 years. And then I think you got to include Northern Illinois, right? Yeah. We're talking about thousands. And then those people went out. And we had kids. By the way, my wife is here. She was in the band, and she's here. And this is going to be our 42nd anniversary. So I know she's over there somewhere, Mary. But Mary played in the band. If you see that our album, oh, by the way, we recorded what? How many? 2 albums. Okay. Nevertheless, all right, moving on. We're going to play this song called The Baron.
Hey, Reggie. Why is it that they just remember the 2 people that went to state? First black man to go to Allstate, Ron Carter.
Yeah, he sure did. Oh, Clarinet, by the way.
I'm not I'm the first.
And by the way, we had fun all the time. We would spend the night on each other's house. We had fun
every day. William Anderson, class of 1982, William Anderson. Man who effectively ended my bass career. I'm gonna break your string after the gig. We'll be right back. We already mentioned class of 81, Mr. Lenny Yarbrough. Class of Bleak, what year were you?
94.
Class of 94, Mr. Delano Redmond. Pepper. Class of 86, Mr. Roderick Pepper Nunn. Rod. Class of 91, Mr. Rod Allen. Who am I leaving out? Who am I leaving out? Where? Y'all don't know the prodigy that this young lady was, and we were just talking about it on the elevator of her being like fourth grader or something like that, young and starting lessons. Class of 94 and now teaching music in East St. Louis, Miss Dawn Daggs. What I forget, Lenny? Okay, I have to make sure I get all the, I keep looking at my phone. I'm not expecting an important call. I need to know what I'm doing. Oh, the next thing is on me, actually. And so rather than me speak, I'm gonna read something that I posted a couple of weeks ago that just disappeared off of my phone. So I gotta, there it is. I'm gonna just read this as I wrote it. Peak to peak. 1981, a group of band kids, concert band and jazz band, were taken into a recording studio in Earth City, Missouri. Many of these students had only been playing their instrument for a couple of years by that time, and hardly any had been introduced to jazz music prior to starting high school. Yet a standard of excellence was already being preached and instilled into these young musicians by two larger-than-life band directors, Michael Dupard and Ronald Carter. In a city often stricken by poverty, at a school surrounded by housing projects that would become known to popular society as the hood, these two individuals showed up in starched shirts and neckties every day, expecting excellence from the students in their charge. We practiced and sight read, and studied and sight read, and sweated and sight read. I remember Dupard relaying the story of a musician who was in prison for years, who came out of jail and presented a recital. When asked how he did it, he explained that they couldn't imprison his mind. So we were never allowed to be imprisoned by our surroundings or our circumstances. Carter often reminded us, "Son, this is where Miles Davis is from. You can't be sucking on that horn like that." They demanded the best from us and made us demand the best of ourselves. So on that day in 1981, we went in to record music that was beyond our current comprehension and at the same time required the best of our abilities and intentions. This was my first time ever having to blow over chord changes on a tune like Lazy Bird, and I had no clue what I was doing. I often joke that my grandchildren will have to listen to that sad piano solo that I played. Actually, I guess that's not a joke, it's the truth. I wouldn't trade these experiences for anything. These gentlemen taught me and so many others that the only way to excel is through the process of hard work and experiences. They provided the model, the hard lessons, the patience, and most importantly, the opportunities and experiences that would lay the foundations of our future success. To Professor Ronald Carter, well done, thy good and faithful servant. If you friend me on Facebook, you can read that on there, but I only mention that because there's a picture of our high school from 1201 Bond that I captioned, where character was built and greatness was revealed. This is from that 1981 album, Peak to Peak. If you look closely at the album cover, you'll see, a face a little more narrow than, body a little more narrow than this one. There was hair somewhere to be found. Hugging a baritone horn like this. But this is one of the tunes that we recorded. This is Joe Zawinul's Birdland. So that was the first record, that this program did. There was another record that we did also. And this next speaker may tell you something about that as well as however else he chooses to speak. He goes back a long way with Professor Carter, including to the same church. His father and Professor Carter were best friends. Please welcome to the microphone Mr. Anthony Wiggins.
How's everybody doing tonight? We thank each of you for being here tonight to celebrate our hero, our father, our mentor, Ronald Carter. Yes. Now, out of all the people on the stage, I probably spent the most time with him. When he moved to this area, he joined my church. And so his joke was, when we were playing at the church, he would stuff a mute in my horn so I could play all the wrong notes I wanted and nobody would hear it. This was like in the fourth grade. And so, and then, of course, I went to Lincoln, and Reggie was talking about these European trips. I don't know anything about that. They went in 82, and then they went in 81? 81, and then they went in 89, and I was not fortunate enough to accompany them on either one of those trips. But and the running joke is I was the favorite. If you heard the service online, our alumnus Russell Gunn made the snide comment that Carter didn't have any favorites except Wig. And he was only serious. So I went to Lincoln. I went to Northern. I left in 87. I went to Northern. And I came back, and I was Carter's assistant at the high school. So a lot of the 91, 92, 93, 94 students, I was a part of their legacy as their instructor. And we were there. Several people in the band were a part of his professional group that he and Vera began Images and Infinity. How many people played in Images and Infinity? We played all the Greek stuff, all the sorority, all the fraternity events, all everything. And if you were not on the stage with them, you were somewhere carrying equipment, running microphone cords and packing up after the show. But and that was called in the professional ranks and in the high school band, the get it band. That means that anything you need, they gonna go get it. Mr. Carter and I, well, I stopped calling Mr. Carter a long time. He was just Carter to me. We talked that week. And he was telling me how he wouldn't be able to make it. I just got installed as pastor the same weekend that the service was. So because of those dynamics, I wasn't able to be at service. But a part of his legacy is having ministers to come out of the band. There are several ministers, several pastors that come out. I'm one. Bruce is one. LaRon Stover, who was here on bass, is one. And we would do gospel concerts. We would go to churches and we wouldn't do any of this music. We would do he would write and arrange gospel songs, hymns, spiritual songs, and we would do it. And so we are just grateful for all that he poured into us, not just in the band room and not just with music, but as being good human beings. And so you see a large spectrum of that represented here on the stage. And so we just say thank you to Ronald Carter, whether he was Mr. Carter, Professor Carter, Brother Chisholm, whatever nickname, Fat Handler, all those nicknames he was. We just say thank you for all that he poured into us. And am I supposed to introduce this song? Okay, and so part of the big band legacy is, of course, doing small group combo type things. And so we're going to do one that was transcended throughout all the years of his stay at Lincoln High School. And we're going to call up Mr. Andre Robeson and Mr. Kendrick Smith, who did not go to Lincoln, but that was because there was no Lincoln. If Lincoln would have been there, I'm sure he would have been at Lincoln. So we're going to give him credit for that. We're going to pull your transcript and write Lincoln on it, just because. And we're going to do a classic small group tune made famous by Dizzy Gillespie, A Night in Tunisia.
Piano players and bring up the great, the phenomenal, the maestro, Professor Reginald Thomas. Thank you.
Anthony Wiggins, Andre Roberson, Kendrick, Buckshot Adderley Smith. Carter was good for that. He was good for giving people nicknames. He didn't give him that one, but I was just continuing the tradition. We were asking this last night, who in the band had a nickname? Reg, we won't bring yours up. We'll leave that one alone. But there were some nicknames in the band. Tanglefoot. Junebug was anybody could be Junebug, right? Sun could be anybody. Let me say that again. Sun could be anybody. So having said that, Sun, come on up to the microphone. Please welcome Don Daggs.
Of course he had to let the mic down for me. Well, good evening, everyone. Of course, my name is Dawn Daggs. Much like Lenny spoke earlier, I actually started playing classical flute. I started playing the flute when I was 7 at Dunbar Elementary School, for those of you that are familiar with 189. Okay. And actually, at that time, I was in the 3rd grade. So 4th grade, of course, I was 8, and that's when I started going over to Lincoln. And of course, play with the concert band, marching band, but most importantly, the jazz band, because that is what gave me the foundation for jazz, because of course, I was a classical musician. Mr. Carter did a lot for me, I'll be honest with you. I went to Berklee College of Music, and I'll say, that was Mr. Carter, okay? He was the one that actually recorded my audition tape. I remember, let's see, now I graduated in 94, but even Tony Wiggins was talking about Mr. Carter wrote gospel songs. I believe the summer of 93, we did a tour of the South. So with that, we had a gospel band and jazz band. And with that tour of the South, we went and we played at Disney World. We went back to Mr. Carter's hometown, we played there. We did a nice little tour, so I will say, thank you, Mr. Carter, for everything that you have done for me and for everyone, to be honest with you. I've said my piece. Yes. Yes. And now we have Mrs. Marjorie Thomas. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I just want to share a bit how Ron Carter changed my life. I did graduate Lincoln, but I wasn't in the band. As an adult, I started singing, and I heard Lincoln's jazz band. And I was doing small groups, but I was like, oh, they are amazing. And they are, and you all still are. And I wanted to sing something with a big band, so I went to Mr. Carter, and I said, I would love to try to sing something with a big band. He said, well, come on. And he said, we've got this chart on spring, can really hang you up the most. And I was like, okay. Little did I know, it wasn't necessarily the best key for me, nor did I realize it had 47 verses that I had to memorize. But I did it gladly because he was that type of person, that type of educator, that he didn't have a ceiling on you. You could go as far as you wanted to go. And so I did it, and I did it with joy. And that was my first experience with the band. So moving forward, we were someplace, and I was doing some things with the band. And I looked up, and Clark Terry was in the horn section. And, you know, I was always just nervous and timid and everything. Clark started doing the Clark thing, and he started scatting. And that's where the chitlins and the cornbread thing came from. Because he did it, and the water felt good, and it looked safe, and I just dove right in and had a wonderful time. And from that point, I fell in love with these young people. They were just amazing, and I still admire them. So they were getting ready to go to Europe, and they were doing fundraisers, and I go sometime and sing and help them raise money. And I was like, well, I love Europe. I should go with you. And I did. So we went, well, I didn't go with the band in the beginning. I think I caught up with them a week later or so. And I got there, and everything was going on as it used to be in the band, and clothes were everywhere, and we get someplace at 7 o'clock, and they're like, well, you perform at 8 o'clock. And shirts were not pressed, and this wasn't done. And it was an act of love to work with these young people and to show them how to fold, roll their clothes so they could pack and travel. And it touches my heart that, you know, now these are some professional musicians, and they'll tell me sometime, you know, you showed me how to pack for the road. I'm like, that touches me. But Ron Carter, he asked a lot, but he gave so much more. And I am forever grateful for the way that he touched my life and my career. And I just rest in gratitude. Thank you all so much.
Speaking of Ron making a way for singers, which I thought that was going to be the segue to Marjorie introducing the next person, but I guess I'll do it. No. Carter believed in there being vocals on every performance that we did, every single one. A singer was always a part of the program, sometimes singing popular tunes that were on the radio that he arranged for the band, sometimes singing jazz standards, but he always made a way for vocalists, and he continued that tradition when he went to Northern Illinois University, where he credits his success there as coming off of the foundation of what he learned working with the young people in East St. Louis Lincoln. And he said, man, when I got to Northern, I had to learn how to teach. No, because the cultural things that he relied on from our community, he would often, when we would do things, he would say he had a band where everybody in the band thought they could rap. Everybody in the band thought they could dance. Then they put it on. And everybody in the band thought they could sing, right? We're going to ask one of the vocalists from the program at Northern Illinois University, Mr. Nicholas Brooks, to come to the stage. Oh, there he is. There he is. You're right up here, sir. While Nicholas is coming, I'm going to tell you why we're doing this song. I was asked by the Madison County Urban League to do some fundraisers, you know, for their events, and they were very gracious. They do whatever idea I said I wanted to do. So I said, well, I want to do what we call a black and tan fantasy. It was based on a Duke Ellington composition, but it was kind of a history of black music in this country where we covered the blues, gospel, jazz. And I said, I want Ronald Carter to come back and be a part of that show. And so I brought him back and had him playing lead alto while I was conducting the band. There were times I wanted him to conduct, so I wrote in his music, get your butt up and conduct. But he was also, and for those who don't know, well, you all know, Carter was a great singer also. So we asked him to play the role of Cab Calloway in that show and come out and do one of Cab's big hits. So he had to exit the stage, go off, put on a white tuxedo, and during the band's introduction, strut out like Cab Calloway. And if you know Carter, he's a ham. He was in it. He was in it. And he was stepping, and with every step, the crowd was just going a little crazier and crazier. He's like, oh, I got him. And the ladies in the front row were going, and they were pointing. And he looked down, and he had neglected to pull that zipper as far up as it was supposed to go. So with every step he took, that zipper went another inch or so. When he finally realized what was going on, he turned around and he walked over in front of the band and he said, "Uh-oh, I better hide the hidey hole." In honor of that moment, Nicholas Brooks and Minnie the Moocher.
Tell me about Minnie the Moocher. She was a young, fine hoochie coocher. She was the toughest, the roughest frail. She had a heart as big as a whale. Hidey, 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 hidey. And ody, 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 oh. Around with a bloke named Smokey. She loved him good, even though he was hokey. He took her down from Chinatown and kicked that gong to the ground. Hidey, 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 hi. Yo, 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 yo. Tell you about the legend Ronald Carter. Some cats could swing, he could swing even harder. He taught us it don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing. And that's why we are here to celebrate that king. Hidey, 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 hidey.
I need my brother back up to the keyboard or piano, whichever one. Don't take all day, son. Come on. Get them knees working. Get them knees working. It was mentioned earlier about Carter employing a lot of students with his group, Images and Infinity. That's where I did still get to play some bass, because I played bass with them while my brother was playing keyboards. And every time we were about to take a break, we played this tune. All y'all better make it funky. Not too fast, son. Put it in the pocket. Long gets excited. That's all right. He's gonna keep smiling, though. Keep smiling, Long. Y'all might wonder what this is up here for. Break it down for me, band. Oh, that was. I like that. That's hip how they did that, wasn't it? Break it down one more time. Hit me! Over the past year, Carter had been being honored at a lot of different places. I was fortunate to go to an event that he was honored at in Chicago by the Chicago Jazz Institute. He was honored at the Midwest Band and Orchestra Clinic. He was with a Lifetime Achievement Award. He was honored at the GEN, Jazz Educators Network National Conference, given a Lifetime Achievement Award. Every time I looked up, they were honoring him. I'm like, hey, what's going on? You know? But I'm glad he got to get his flowers, at least a portion of his flowers, while he was here to receive them. Is that all right? Can anybody tell me what this is? It's a bucket. Anybody got any bucket list items that you have, right? Bucket list. Here would be a great bucket list item to get to be able to see. How many folks could say they got to see their son win a Tony Award? Ronald Carter. How many would get to say they crossed off their bucket list seeing their son get a Grammy Award? Ronald Carter. How many folks can say, and I believe this is the only person that can say this, that I had two of my former students to hold the piano chair in the Count Basie Orchestra? Ronald Carter. Professor Carter touched so many people's lives that I asked the folks in the band, just give me, you know, something for his bucket list. I'm just kind of pulling out. Reginald Gully, East St. Louis Lincoln graduate 1988, trombone, bass trombone. Mr. Carter was a great influence. He was a true father figure. If it wasn't for Mr. Carter, excuse me, who knows what I will be doing. Great teacher, leader, and all around person. Mary and Lenny E. Yarbrough Sr., class of 1981. 42 years later, I just want to continue the love he had for us all. John Siddle, Belleville West High School, 1988. I was not a student of Mr. Carter, but I was fortunate to work with him at a high school festival. I'll figure that out in a minute. I was sorry to see this big jazz educator pass, and wish you all the best. Bernard Long, NIU, 2009. Mr. Carter was my musical father. Thank you. There's one more here, maybe. Oh, look at this. Dr. Pepper. Dr. Roderick Pepper Nunn, Lincoln class of 86, trombone. Mr. Carter's teaching, mentorship, and support has meant so much to me, not just as a musician, but as a leader. The experience in the jazz band room taught me how to lead, communicate, be creative, and pursue excellence in everything I do. That has carried me throughout my career as an alderman, college president, wow, and something vice president. I can't make out that word, Pepper. Corporate vice president. I'm gonna show y'all what that looks like. It says corporate though. With love, Pepper. These are just a few of the testaments of what Carter's meant to so many people's lives. Just a few. Are there any other folks out here who were touched by Professor Ronald Carter? Anybody sitting out here? Is that Sinead sitting right there? Hey, Sinead. So I know it's some folks sitting out there. I've got some more cards here. We're going to present these to the family just so that they understand. We really appreciate them loaning us Professor Carter for so long. That's a sacrifice on the family. That's a sacrifice on the part of his wife when he was never home on a weekend because he was off at a jazz band festival. When he was never home because he was traveling to other countries spreading this gospel, spreading this news. If anybody has anything you want to write, I got some more cards here. You can write them at the end and put them in this bucket list. There are also ways that you can donate to causes that were of particular interest to Professor Carter. One, there is a scholarship in his name at Northern Illinois University that is to be given to a student in jazz. There's another scholarship fund that we're going to reactivate. We never closed it, but after Lincoln closed down and, or not so much Lincoln, but the program at Eastside had closed down for a bit. But we had started a Michael Dupart Ronald Carter scholarship, which I believe Kendrick Smith received one of those scholarships. We are going to reactivate that as well. And the last cause that he was really interested in was getting jazz going at HBCUs, just as they are at other institutions. This is what he was passionate about, and this was the last thing that he was really working on. That HBCU festival is this Saturday. I will fly down and be a part of the celebration there, but they're going to try to continue that festival in his honor. So look for, watch your social media, and you'll see how that you can give to those accounts. If you want to add to the bucket list, you can do that. All right, is that all right? Here we go. One, two, three, four. A member for many years of Images and Infinity, he also did his student teaching at Lincoln High School under Professor Carter on guitar, Mr. Thomas Moore. Have y'all had a good time tonight? Have we told the story? Well, we're gonna do one more special thing for you, and this was a piece written by Professor Carter. He was commissioned to write this, but saying this, Carter didn't believe in, well, there's no students out there, so my program just gonna be what it is because we can't find no students somewhere. He was gonna make a student. I'm serious. He did that a couple of times. He did it at Lincoln High School, where rather than send his kids off to a summer band program, he created a summer band program at Lincoln. That's how we got introduced to a Darren Pops Jackson, because he was coming down and being a part of those lessons at Lincoln. I believe, Aaron, did you come down and get some of those lessons as well? My own son, Aaron Banks, came down and participated in those. So he didn't take it, you know, well, we ain't got no students. He made them. He did the same thing in Chicago. There were not enough students of color in the program, and he was like, well, where are the students? Well, there's some in Chicago. So he'd get into the Chicago schools, and then, well, where are the students? Well, they weren't there. So he went into the south side of Chicago, and he started what he called the South Shore Program, where even though he was teaching during the week at Northern Illinois University, on the weekends, he was going over and running a youth program that then funneled students from there into college, produced players such as Mr. Marquise Hill, who is the former winner of the Thelonious Monk competition and one of the top trumpeters out there in the world right now. So we thank him for that work. This piece he wrote dedicated to that. This is called the South Side Shuffle.
Thank you.
one more time for the Lincoln High School Jazz Band, Northern Illinois University Reunion Ensemble. Come on, give it up, give it up, give it up. Don Daggs on the flute. Mr. Lenny Yarbrough on the flute. Roderick Allen on the tenor saxophone. Harvey Lockhart on the alto saxophone. Andre Roberson on the alto saxophone. Bernard Thomas on the tenor saxophone. Kendrick Smith on the baritone saxophone. Roderick Nunn on the trombone. John Siddle on the trombone. Reginald Gully on the trombone. Mr. Anthony Wiggins on the trumpet. Mr. Adam Hookey on lead trumpet. Mr. Jason Brown on the trumpet. Mr. Delano Redmond on the trumpet. Mr. Eddie Thomas on piano. Mr. Bruce Allen on piano. Mr. Thomas Moore on the guitar. Mr. LaRon Stover on the bass. Mr. John King on the bass. Mr. William Anderson on the bass. Mr. Bernard Long Jr. on the drums. Mr. Devin Legrone on the drums. Oh, bring it on down, bring it on down.
Mr. Rachel Thomas.
Before folks start talking about I forgot somebody, I haven't forgotten anybody. Oh, y'all in a hurry to leave? Y'all in a hurry to get out the door? I mean, we could just stop right now if you want us to get out the door. Hang on, I got one more thing to say. End it right here for me, man. You'll notice that there's one person that I have not introduced all night on the stage. Hang on, son, I got this. Mama, grab your son. That I have not introduced, that's been up here all night, been standing all night, right? But we want to give a special recognition to this person. That's Mr. Earl Allen on percussion. Earl Allen worked for the district for many years, many, many years. But he also was a part of this family and this legacy. Carter believed in it being a family. He really did. And so he invited all kinds of folks to play with us, right? Y'all remember Reverend Lang? Reverend Lang used to get up and play some tenor with us. Calvin, the janitor, used to get up and sing some blues with us, right? But Earl, no matter what needed done, Earl got done. Earl helped us transport equipment. Earl was there with us early whenever we were going anywhere. Earl was there with us late when we were leaving and having to break down and get stuff back where it was supposed to be. Earl was sitting in with the band, would lose his sticks every time and start playing the drums with his hands. For every part of what we did throughout the history of this ensemble, Earl Allen was there. Earl, thank you. I did not mention, you heard from a couple of singers already. You heard from Nicholas Brooks. You also heard from Marjorie Thomas. But this evening would not be complete. It would not be complete without a couple of things. One was how Ron ended every concert. We used to do these Mother's Day concerts at the biggest ballroom in St. Louis and sell them out every year, right? Now, part of that, this song kind of crept into that. It crept into Northern Illinois University. Where I remember doing it the most was playing with Images and Infinity. Carter switched me to piano, but what he did immediately was hire me to play bass with his band. So from the time I was 15, I was playing bass in his professional band. And I was a young-looking 15. I was. I probably looked like I was about 12. And he had us out in all kinds of places I had no business being. Till all times of the morning sometimes. But my mom was okay with it because she knew I was with my teacher. Everything was all right. I might run into some of my teachers there. Great thing about that, they look at me like, what you doing here? And I'd look back at them like, what you doing here? So that became a part of our culture. I told you vocalists were always a part of the culture. And one of those vocalists who, Lord, at the time, we didn't know she was going to make it as a singer. We didn't know. Wait, am I telling the truth? Did Carter stay in your behind? I think he lost a couple of pairs of shoes that way. But as I told her last night, he was so proud of her and everybody in this program. And now, in May, in four weeks, she's about to receive her doctorate in education. So we're going to call up two more people. As I say, Carter kept this as a family. One of the members of that family was our art teacher, Mr. Richard Hunt. We're going to call him up to play some drums. And y'all please make some racket for Miss Erica Johnson. And if y'all don't sing on this one, if you don't know what it is, we about to school you. Come on up, by the way.
As we transition to this last song, I'm going to say a couple of things because after this, there's not going to be nothing to say. It's going to be the end of the show. But on behalf of Jazz St. Louis, I want to say thank you to all of these amazing people that came together for this retrospective, this tribute to Ron Carter. They showed up here at the club at 8 o'clock last night to rehearse, to put this together. And not everyone lives here now. Some people traveled in order to be here, to be a part of this. And did we leave here at about 11 or 11:30 last night, I think, to come right back here? One of those Carter rehearsals. But they put the work in, as they'd done when they were a part of the programs in the various places where he taught, and to come together and to have a family reunion, maybe the biggest, ugliest, fattest family reunion that ever was, but I'm just joking. This is a joke. This is a joke. You can laugh. You can laugh. It's all right. You can laugh. And I'm one of them. It's all right. You can laugh. No. It has been an absolute pleasure. I'd like to thank the Whitaker Foundation. They're the ones who sponsored tonight. Give them a hand once again. These concert series allow things like this to happen, to have 30,000 people on the stage in order to give tribute to someone. And so we're so grateful for their support. Once again, this is the East St. Louis Lincoln, Northern Illinois University, Extension, Reunion, Alumni, Band, Reggie Thomas. We'll be right back.
say your party's jumping, and everybody's having a good time. But you know what's going through my mind. Do you mind if I get comfortable and kick off these shoes? You're fixing me a drink, baby, some of them down home blues. She say, you know me, I don't get out much on the town. And you know how to cut out a lot of that running around all week long. Tonight I'm gonna do as I choose. Oh yes. So why don't you take off them fast records and play me some of them down hall blues? Come on, sing it with me, y'all. Down home blues, down home blues. Oh, she wanted to hear those down home blues all night long. Every other record or two. Oh yes. So why don't you take off them fast records and play me some of them down home blues? All right, what you got? Come on, y'all. We'll be right back. that you are acknowledging our teacher, our educator. This is a family, and this family keeps going. One thing that Mr. Carter taught us was that no matter what, whether it be 70, 80, 90, 2010s or 20s, we take care of each other and we uphold each other. We have a legacy that is so important because of Images in Infinity and Ron Carter and Vera Bolden pouring into us. Because of you, we are Vera Bolden. Ladies and gentlemen. This is my musical godmother. She raised me, Ron Carter raised us. Mama, you want this microphone right here?
This will work.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the legendary Vera Bolden.
You got me running, you got me hiding, you got me run, hide, ride, run, any way you wanna let it flow. Got me doing what you want me, anything you want me to do. Somebody call the plumber, must be a leak in my drain. Somebody call the plumber, must be a leak in my drain. Everybody knows about my good thing.
No, me, I don't get out. Vera Bolden, everybody. We were raised by the best of the best. Mr. Carter taught Reggie. Reggie taught us. He taught Pops. And this legacy will continue like ripples in a stream. Mr. Carter is still here with us. And this legacy will continue as long as we remember that excellence is our birthright. So we thank you, Mr. Carter. So everybody, I want you to get your napkin. Get your paper, get your napkin. Just want you to wave it in the air. There you go. We're going to end this thing right. Here we go. She say, you know, my husband don't want to fight. Why don't you take off? Hey, wait, hold on. So why don't you say ow? So why don't you say ow? Them fast records. And play me, 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 play me. Some of them down home blue.
Retrospective of Ron Carter, East St. Louis Lincoln High School. Thank you all for coming out. Have a great night.